Robert Schumann. Robert Schumann was a German composer and influential music critic. He is widely regarded as one of the greatest composers of the Romantic era. Schumann left the study of law, intending to pursue a career as a virtuoso pianist. His teacher, Friedrich Wieck, a German pianist, had assured him that he could become the finest pianist in Europe, but a hand injury ended this dream. Schumann then focused his musical energies on composing. In 1840, after a long and acrimonious legal battle with Wieck, who opposed the marriage, Schumann married Wieck's daughter Clara. Before their marriage, Clara, also a composer, had substantially supported her father through her considerable career as a pianist. Together, Clara and Robert encouraged and maintained a close relationship with Johannes Brahms. Until 1840, Schumann wrote exclusively for the piano. Later, he composed piano and orchestral works, many Lieder. He composed four symphonies, one opera, and other orchestral, choral, and chamber works. His most famous works include Carnival, Symphonic Studies, Kinderszenen, Kreisleriana, and the Fantasie in C. His writings about music appeared mostly in the Neue Zeitschrift für Musik, a Leipzig-based publication that he co-founded. Schumann suffered from a mental disorder that first manifested in 1833 as a severe melancholic depressive episode, which recurred several times, alternating with phases of exaltation and increasingly also delusional ideas of being poisoned or threatened with metallic items. After a suicide attempt in 1854, Schumann was admitted at his own request to a mental asylum in Andenick near Bonn. Diagnosed with psychotic melancholia, he died 2 years later in 1856 at the age of 46 without recovering from his mental illness. Schumann was born in Zwickau, in the Kingdom of Saxony, the fifth and last child of Johanna Christiane and August Schumann. Schumann began to compose before the age of seven, but his boyhood was spent in the cultivation of literature as much as music. Undoubtedly influenced by his father, a bookseller, publisher, and novelist. At age seven, Schumann began studying general music and piano with Johann Gottfried Gnsch, a teacher at the Zwickau High School. The boy immediately developed a love of music, and worked on his own compositions, without the aid of Gnsch. Even though he often disregarded the principles of musical composition, he created works regarded as admirable for his age. The Universal Journal of Music 1850 supplement included a biographical sketch of Schumann that noted, "It has been related that Schumann, as a child, possessed rare taste and talent for portraying feelings and characteristic traits in melody. A. He could sketch the different dispositions of his intimate friends by certain figures and passages on the piano so exactly and comically that everyone burst into loud laughter at the similitude of the portrait." At age 14, Schumann wrote an essay on the aesthetics of music and also contributed to a volume, edited by his father, titled Portraits of Famous Men. While still at school in Zwickau, he read the works of the German poet-philosophers Schiller and Goethe, as well as Byron and the Greek tragedians. His most powerful and permanent literary inspiration was Jean Paul, a German writer whose influence is seen in Schumann's youthful novels Junius Abend, completed in 1826, and Selene. Schumann's interest in music was sparked by attending a performance of Ignaz Moscheles playing at Karlsbad, and he later developed an interest in the works of Beethoven, Schubert, and Mendelssohn. His father, who had encouraged his musical aspirations, died in 1826 when Schumann was 16. Thereafter, neither his mother nor his guardian encouraged him to pursue a music career. In 1828, Schumann left school, and after a tour during which he met Heinrich Heine in Munich, he went to Leipzig to study law. In 1829, he continued his law studies in Heidelberg, where he became a lifelong member of Corps Saxo Borussia Heidelberg. During Eastertide 1830, he heard the Italian violinist, violist, guitarist, and composer Niccolò Paganini play in Frankfurt. In July he wrote to his mother, "My whole life has been a struggle between poetry and prose, or call it music and law." By Christmas he was back in Leipzig, at age 20, taking piano lessons from his old master Friedrich Wieck, who assured him that he would be a successful concert pianist after a few years' study with him. During his studies with Wieck, some stories claim that Schumann permanently injured a finger on his right hand. Wieck claimed that Schumann damaged his finger by using a mechanical device that held back one finger while he exercised the others, which was supposed to strengthen the weakest fingers. Clara Schumann discredited the story, saying the disability was not due to a mechanical device, and Robert Schumann himself referred to it as an affliction of the whole hand. Some argue that, As the disability appeared to have been chronic and have affected the hand, and not just a finger, it was not likely caused by a finger-strengthening device. Schumann abandoned the idea of a concert career and devoted himself instead to composition. To this end he began a study of music theory under Heinrich Dorn, a German composer 6 years his senior and, at that time, conductor of the Leipzig Opera. About this time Schumann considered composing an opera in the subject of Hamlet. The fusion of literary ideas with musical ones, known as program music, may have first taken shape in Papillon, Opus 2, a musical portrayal of events in Jean-Paul's novel Die Flügelhörer. In a letter from Leipzig dated April 1832, Schumann bids his brothers read the last scene in Jean-Paul's Flügelhörer as soon as possible, because the Papillon are intended as a musical representation of that masquerade. This inspiration is foreshadowed to some extent in his first written criticism, an 1831 essay on Frédéric Chopin's variations on a theme from Mozart's Don Giovanni, published in the Allgemeine Musikalische Zeitung. In it, Schumann creates imaginary characters who discuss Chopin's work, Florestan and Eusebius, the counterparts of Wolf and Walt in Flügelhörer. They call on a third, Meister Raro, for his opinion. Raro may represent either the composer himself, Wieck's daughter Clara, or the combination of the two. In the winter of 1832, at age 22, Schumann visited relatives in Zwickau and Schneeberg, where he performed the first movement of his symphony in G minor. In Zwickau, the music was performed at a concert given by Clara Wieck, who was then just 13 years old. On this occasion Clara played Bravura variations by Henri Hertz, a composer whom Schumann was already deriding as a Philistine. Schumann's mother said to Clara, "You must marry my Robert one day." The symphony in G minor was not published during Schumann's lifetime, but has been played and recorded in recent times. The 1833 deaths of Schumann's brother Julius and his sister-in-law Rosalie in the worldwide cholera pandemic brought on a severe depressive episode. By spring 1834, Schumann had sufficiently recovered to inaugurate Die Neue Zeitschrift für Musik, first published on April 3, 1834. Schumann published most of his critical writings in the journal, and often lambasted the popular taste for flashy technical displays from figures whom Schumann perceived as inferior composers. Schumann campaigned to revive interest in major composers of the past, including Mozart, Beethoven, and Weber. He also promoted the work of some contemporary composers, including Chopin and Hector Berlioz, whom he praised for creating music of substance. On the other hand, Schumann disparaged the school of Franz Liszt and Richard Wagner. Among Schumann's associates at this time were composers Norbert Burgmüller and Ludwig Schunk. During the summer of 1834 Schumann became engaged to 16-year-old Ernestina von Fricken, the adopted daughter of a rich Bohemian-born noble. In August 1835, he learned that Ernestina von Fricken was born illegitimate, which meant that she would have no dowry. Fearful that her limited means would force him to earn his living like a day laborer, Schumann made a complete break with her toward the end of the year. He felt a growing attraction to 15-year-old Clara Wieck. They made mutual declarations of love in December in Zwickau, where Clara appeared in concert. His budding romance with Clara was disrupted when her father learned of their trysts during the Christmas holidays. He summarily forbade them further meetings, and ordered all their correspondence burned. Carnival, Opus 9, is one of Schumann's most characteristic piano works. Schumann begins nearly every section of Carnival with a musical cryptogram, the musical notes signified in German by the letters that spell Ash, the Bohemian town in which Ernestina was born, and the notes are also the musical letters and Schumann's own name. Eusebius and Florestan, the imaginary figures appearing so often in his critical writings, also appear, alongside brilliant imitations of Chopin and Paganini. The work comes to a close with the March of the Davidsbündler, the League of King David's Men against the Philistines, in which may be heard the clear accents of truth in contest with the dull clamor of falsehood embodied in a quotation from the 17th century grandfather's dance. The march, a step nearly always in duple meter, is here in three-quarters time. The work ends in joy and a degree of mock triumph. In Carnival, Schumann went further than in Papillon, by conceiving the story as well as the musical representation. On October 3, 1835, Schumann met Felix Mendelssohn at Wieck's house in Leipzig, and his enthusiastic appreciation of that artist was shown with the same generous freedom that distinguished his acknowledgement of the greatness of Chopin and other colleagues, and later prompted him to publicly pronounce the then unknown Johannes Brahms a genius. In 1837 Schumann published his Symphonic Studies, a complex set of etude-like variations written in 1834 to 1835, which demanded a finished piano technique. These variations were based on a theme by the adoptive father of Ernestina von Fricken. The work, described as one of the peaks of the piano literature, lofty in conception and faultless in workmanship, Hutcheson, - was dedicated to the young English composer William Sterndale Bennett, for whom Schumann had had a high regard when they worked together in Leipzig. The Davidsbündler Tänze, Opus 6, literally Dances of the League of David, is an embodiment of the struggle between enlightened Romanticism and musical Philistinism. Schumann credited the two sides of his character with the composition of the work and the more dreamy side E. The work begins with the motto of C.W., denoting her support for the ideals of the Davidsbund. The Bund was a work of Schumann's imagination, members of which were kindred spirits such as Chopin, Paganini, and Clara, as well as the personalized Florestan and Eusebius. Kinderszenen, Opus 15, completed in 1838 and a favorite of Schumann's piano works, depicts the innocence and playfulness of childhood. The Träumerei in F major, number 7 of the set, is one of the most famous piano pieces ever written, and has been performed in myriad forms and transcriptions. It has been the favorite encore of several great pianists, including Vladimir Horowitz. Melodic and deceptively simple, the piece is complex in its harmonic structure. Kreisleriana, Opus 16, considered one of Schumann's greatest works, carried his fantasy and emotional range deeper. Johannes Kreisler was a fictional musician created by poet E.T.A. Hoffmann, and characterized as a romantic brought into contact with reality. Schumann used the figure to express emotional states in music that is fantastic and mad. According to Hutcheson, this work is among the finest efforts of Schumann's genius. He never surpassed the searching beauty of the slow movements or the urgent passion of others. To appreciate it, a high level of aesthetic intelligence is required. This is no facile music, there is severity alike in its beauty and its passion. The Fantasie in C, Opus 17, composed in the summer of 1836, is a work of passion and deep pathos, imbued with the spirit of the late Beethoven. Schumann intended to use proceeds from sales of the work toward the construction of a monument to Beethoven, who had died in 1827. The first movement of the Fantasie contains a musical quote from Beethoven's song cycle, Undiefern Geliebte, Opus 98. The original titles of the movements were Ruins, Triumphal Arch, and the Starry Crown. According to Franz Liszt, who played the work for Schumann and to whom it was dedicated, the Fantasie was apt to be played too heavily, and should have a dreamier character than vigorous German pianists tended to impart. Liszt also said, "It is a noble work, worthy of Beethoven, whose career, by the way, it is supposed to represent." Again, according to Hutcheson, no words can describe the Fantasie, no quotations set forth the majesty of its genius. It must suffice to say that it is Schumann's greatest work in large form for piano solo. After a visit to Vienna, during which he discovered Franz Schubert's previously unknown Symphony No. 9 in C, in 1839 Schumann wrote the Faschingsschwan Kaspien. Most of the joke is in the central section of the first movement, which makes a thinly veiled reference to La Marseillaise. The festive mood does not preclude moments of melancholic introspection in Intermezzo. From 1832 to 1839, Schumann wrote almost exclusively for piano, but in 1840 alone he wrote at least 138 songs. Indeed, 1840 is highly significant in Schumann's musical legacy, despite his earlier deriding of works for piano and voice as inferior. After a long and acrimonious legal battle with her father, Schumann married Clara Wieck on September 12, 1840, at Schönefeld, the day before her 21st birthday. Had they waited another day, they would no longer have required her father's consent. Their marriage supported a remarkable business partnership, with Clara acting as an inspiration, critic, and confidant to her husband. Despite her delicate appearance, she was an extremely strong-willed and energetic woman, who kept up a demanding schedule of concert tours in between bearing several children. 2 years after their marriage, Friedrich Wieck at last reconciled himself with the couple, eager to see his grandchildren. Prior to the legal case and subsequent marriage, the lovers exchanged love letters and rendezvoused in secret. Robert often waited for hours in a cafe in a nearby city just to see Clara for a few minutes after one of her concerts. The strain of this long courtship and its consummation may have led to this great outpouring off leader. This is evident in Widmung, for example, where he uses the melody from Schubert's Ave Maria in the postlude in homage to Clara. Schumann's biographers attribute the sweetness, doubt, and despair of these songs to the emotions aroused by his love for Clara and the uncertainties of their future together. Robert and Clara had 8 children, Emil, who died at 1 year, Marie, Elise, Julie, Ludwig, Ferdinand, Eugenie, and Felix. His chief song cycles in this period were settings of the Liederkreis of Joseph von Eichendorff, Opus 39, the Frauenliebe und Leben of Chamisso, Opus 42, the Dichterliebe of Heine, Opus 48, and Morden, a collection of songs, including poems by Goethe, Rückert, Heine, Byron, Burns, and more. The songs Belsazar, Opus 57 and Die Beiden Grenadiere, Opus 49, both to Heine's words, show Schumann at his best as a ballad writer, although the dramatic ballad is less congenial to him than the introspective lyric. The Op. 35, 40 and 98 A sets, although less well known, also contain songs of lyric and dramatis quality. In 1841 he wrote two of his four symphonies, No. 1 in B-flat, Opus 38, Spring and No. 4 in D minor. He devoted 1842 to composing chamber music, including the piano quintet in E-flat, Opus 44, now one of his best-known and most admired works, the piano quartet and three-string quartets. In 1843 he wrote Paradise and the Peri, his first essay at concerted vocal music, an oratorio-style work based on Lalla-Rookh by Thomas More. After this, his compositions were not confined to any one form during any particular period. The stage in his life when he was deeply engaged in setting Goethe's Faust to music was a critical one for his health. He spent the first half of 1844 with Clara on tour in Russia. On returning to Germany, he abandoned his editorial work and left Leipzig for Dresden, where he suffered from persistent nervous prostration. As soon as he began to work, he was seized with fits of shivering and an apprehension of death, experiencing an abhorrence of high places, all metal instruments, and drugs. Schumann's diaries also state that he suffered perpetually from imagining that he had the note A5 sounding in his ears. His state of unease and neurasthenia is reflected in his symphony in C, numbered second, but third in order of composition, in which the composer explores states of exhaustion, obsession and depression, culminating in Beethovenian spiritual triumph. Also published in 1845 was his piano concerto in A minor, Opus 54, originally conceived and performed as a one-movement fantasy for piano and orchestra in 1841. It is one of the most popular and oft-recorded of all piano concertos. According to Hutchison, Schumann achieved a masterly work and we inherited the finest piano concerto since Mozart and Beethoven. In 1846, he felt he had recovered. In the winter, the Schumanns revisited Vienna, traveling to Prague and Berlin in the spring of 1847 and in the summer to Zwickau, where he was received with enthusiasm. This pleased him, since until that time he was famous in only Dresden and Leipzig. His only opera, Genoveva, Opus 81, premiered in spring 1850. In it, Schumann attempted to abolish recitative, which he regarded as an interruption to the musical flow. The subject of Genoveva, based on Ludwig Tieck and Christian Friedrich Hebbel, was not an ideal choice. The text is often considered to lack dramatic qualities. The work has not remained in the repertoire. As early as 1842, the possibilities of German opera had been keenly realized by Schumann, who wrote, "Do you know my prayer as an artist, night and morning? It is called German opera. Here is a real field for enterprise, something simple, profound, German." And in his notebook of suggestions for the text of operas are found amongst others, Nibelungen, Lohengrin and Till Eulenspiegel. The music to Byron's Manfred was written in 1849, the overture of which is one of Schumann's most frequently performed orchestral works. The insurrection of Dresden caused Schumann to move to Kreischa, a little village a few miles outside the city. In August 1849, on the occasion of the centenary of Goethe's birth, such scenes of Schumann's scenes from Goethe's Faust as were already completed were performed in Dresden, Leipzig, and Weimar. Liszt gave him assistance and encouragement. The rest of the work was written later in 1849, and the overture in 1853. From 1850 to 1854, Schumann composed in a wide variety of genres. Critics have disputed the quality of his work at this time. A widely held view has been thought his music showed signs of mental breakdown and creative decay. More recently, critics have suggested that the changes in style may be explained by elusive experimentation. In 1850, Schumann succeeded Ferdinand Hiller as musical director at Düsseldorf, but he was a poor conductor and quickly aroused the opposition of the musicians. According to Harold C. Schoenberg, in his 1967 The Great Conductors, the great composer was impossible on the platform. There is something heartrending about poor Schumann's epochal inefficiency as a conductor. His contract was eventually terminated. By the end of that year, he completed his Symphony No. 3, Rhenish. In 1851, he revised what would be published as his Fourth Symphony. From 1851 to 1853, he visited Switzerland, Belgium, and Leipzig. On September 30, 1853, the 20-year-old composer Johannes Brahms arrived unannounced at the door of the Schumanns carrying a letter of introduction from violinist Joseph Joachim. Brahms amazed Clara and Robert with his music, stayed with them for several weeks, and became a close family friend. During this time, Schumann, Brahms and Schumann's pupil Albert Dietrich collaborated on the composition of the FAE Sonata for Joachim. Schumann also published an article, Neue Bahnen in the Neue Zeitschrift, hailing the unknown young Brahms from Hamburg, a man who had published nothing, as the chosen one who was destined to give ideal expression to the times. It was an extraordinary way to present Brahms to the musical world, setting up great expectations that he did not fulfill for many years. In January 1854, Schumann went to Hanover, where he heard a performance of his Paradise in the Pieri organized by Joachim and Brahms. 2 years later, at Schumann's request, the work received its first English performance conducted by William Sterndale Bennett. Schumann returned to Düsseldorf and began to edit his complete works and make an anthology on the subject of music. He suffered a renewal of the symptoms that had threatened him earlier. Besides the single note sounding in his ear, he imagined that voices sounded in his ear and he heard angelic music. One night he suddenly left his bed, having dreamt or imagined that a ghost had dictated a spirit theme to him. The theme was one he had used several times before, in his second string quartet, again in his Lieder album for Die Jugend, and finally in the slow movement of his violin concerto. In the days leading up to his suicide attempt, Schumann wrote 5 variations on this theme for the piano, his last completed work, today known as the Geister Variation in. Brahms published it in a supplementary volume to the complete edition of Schumann's Piano Music. In 1861, Brahms published his Variations for Piano 4 Hands, Opus 23, based on this theme. In late February 1854, Schumann's symptoms increased, the angelic vision sometimes being replaced by demonic ones. He warned Clara that he feared he might do her harm. On 27 February, he attempted suicide by throwing himself from a bridge into the Rhine River. Rescued by boatmen and taken home, he asked to be taken to an asylum for the insane. He entered Dr. Franz Richards's sanatorium in Endenich, a quarter of Bonn, and remained there until he died on July 29, 1856 at the age of 46. During his confinement, he was not allowed to see Clara, although Brahms was free to visit him. Clara finally visited him 2 days before his death. He appeared to recognize her, but was able to speak only a few words. Given his reported symptoms, one modern view is that he died from syphilis, which he could have contracted during his student days, and which could have remained latent during most of his marriage. According to studies by the musicologist and literary scholar Eric Sams, Schumann's symptoms during his terminal illness and death appear consistent with those of mercury poisoning. Mercury was a common treatment for syphilis and other conditions. Another possibility is that his neurological problems were the result of an intracranial mass. A report by Janisch and Nauhaus on Schumann's autopsy indicates that he had a gelatinous tumor at the base of the brain. It may have represented a colloid cyst, a craniopharyngioma, a chordoma, or a chordoid meningioma. In particular, meningiomas are known to produce musical auditory hallucinations such as Schumann reported. It has also been hypothesized that he suffered from either schizophrenia or bipolar disorder and bipolar II disorder. Other sources have supported a diagnosis of bipolar disorder, citing his mood swings and changes in productivity. Schumann heard a persistent A note at the end of his life. It was a form of tinnitus, or perhaps an auditory hallucination related to his major depressive episode. At times, he had musical hallucinations that were longer than just the single A, but his diaries include comments about hearing that annoying single note. After Robert's death, Clara continued her successful career as a concert pianist, which supported the family. From mid-career on, she mainly performed music by leading composers. A hired cook and housekeeper tended to the children while she traveled. In 1856, she first visited England. The critics received Robert's music coolly, with Henry Fothergill Chorley being particularly harsh. She returned to London in 1865 and made regular appearances here in later years, often performing chamber music with the violinist Joseph Joachim and others. She became the authoritative editor of her husband's works for Breitkopf and Herdl. It was rumored that she and Brahms destroyed many of Schumann's later works, which they thought were tainted by his madness, but only the five pieces for cello and piano are known to have been destroyed. Most of Schumann's late works, particularly the violin concerto, the fantasy for violin and orchestra and the violin sonata No. 3, all from 1853, have entered the repertoire. Schumann had considerable influence in the 19th century and beyond, despite his adoption of more conservative modes of composition after his marriage. He left an array of acclaimed music in virtually all the forms then known. Partly through his protégé Brahms, Schumann's ideals and musical vocabulary became widely disseminated. Composer Sir Edward Elgar called Schumann my ideal. Schumann has often been confused with Austrian composer Franz Schubert. One well-known example occurred in 1956, when East Germany issued a pair of postage stamps featuring Schumann's picture against an open score that featured Schubert's music. The stamps were soon replaced by a pair featuring music written by Schumann. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.